A real teacher is a teacher of reality. And what they do in this world is they simply radiate this perfect assurance that everything that's happening in existence is entirely inconsequential to reality, to what we are, and that reality will never ever generate anything that we really want. And they simply radiate that assurance to us. That's it. That's a real teacher. And we need that type of teacher now more than ever before. Why? Because there is going to be a massive upsurge in change and activity and seeming consequentiality in the world. Suddenly, the world will seem extremely consequential, everything that's happening. And the danger is that we will get swept up in that belief in consequentiality here. And if we get swept up in it, we get swept away. On the other side, though, if there is that radiating assurance that there's no consequentiality to what's taking place in existence at all, ever, and existence can never generate anything that we really want, ever, we can simply abide in that attitude, that presence, and we will not get swept up in the belief in consequentiality. And then our destiny will be one of awakening to unconditional love and the isness, the I Am presence, waking up to reality. We will go on that path. So it's super important right now to aim for that situation, which is what I've been doing for a long time, aiming for the situation where we'll be able to abide in this presence of inconsequentiality to what's taking place in the world. And it's better if that situation be somewhere set aside, not in the mainstream of activity. For instance, if it's in some kind of big city where there's just massive bustling and stuff taking place all the time, it's pretty tough to detach. And whereas if it's just in some place that's very serene, setting where there's really nothing going on, it's easy to get out of that slipstream of all the activity and simply sit there quietly and be reassured. So my aim is to be in such a place. Hopefully there'll be some teacher of reality there. I'm not a teacher of reality at this point at all, because it requires 100% certainty. You see, right now there's a strong conceptual and a certainty, a strong clarification, etc., but not 100%. It requires 100% absolute unshakable certainty that everything in existence is entirely inconsequential to reality. Everything in a dream is entirely inconsequential to reality. 100% assurance of that. And then when it's 100%, it simply radiates out like that. See, there's no manipulation of it. It's just a pure radiation of it. Big difference between 100% and 99%. Huge, massive difference. So, the idea is to be in a place that is sort of off the beaten track, sort of beautiful, serene, calm place where nothing much is happening at all. You know, you might call it extremely boring. Nothing is happening, really. Humdrum. And then to be there to tape, to do tapings and share videos for everyone in the world, to get that feeling that no matter what happens in existence, it doesn't have any consequence to our true identity, to reality, to our true home. All that is totally untouched by anything that could ever happen in existence. Just as the dreamer is totally untouched by the dream. So we're trying to prepare for such a possibility, because the world is most certainly going to take on a massive upswing in events and circumstances and situations of sweeping change and instability and turmoil and activism and hubbub and you know, it's just everything's going to be, you know, up in the air like this. And the temptation is to start, you know, thinking that it's consequential and say, well, what do I do? What do I do? And get pulled into it by focusing on it, by focusing on all that stuff. Whereas the way that really will save you is to not focus on it. Instead, focus on the non-consequentiality. Okay. It's very difficult to be so-called neutral. There are no neutral thoughts. So it's very difficult to say, well, I'm just going to be neutral. It's not possible. We always have a focus in this world. And if we just say, well, I don't believe it's consequential, any of this stuff, but where's our focus still, you see? It's better to have a positive focus and saying, I am focused on that this is non-consequential. I'm focused on this radiation of assurance. That's better than just trying to say, well, I want to just ignore this and push it away, push it away, push it away. There needs to be a stronger focus of, say, I have this very positive assurance of non-consequentiality of existence, that existence can never develop anything that I really want. And focus on that. That is by far the best remedy for the times. Extremely important remedy. And those are the two options. We'll have two options going forward. And the idea that we can kind of play it halfway is foolish, because there's a collective consciousness of the world, and that collective consciousness gets, you know, hive mentality when a beehive starts swarming, you know, that gets into all the bees, and they all, you know, the ones that are going to swarm really do swarm. And when the whole world is caught up in this fervor, okay, it won't work to just say, well, I'm going to kind of halfway this and halfway that and try to manipulate it, and it just won't work. It won't work well. You'll feel like you're being left behind, or you're being isolated, or you know, it will work on your belief systems, will work on you and undermine and make you feel like you need to get with it somehow. And one way or another, it's like a massive flood, you know, coming through, and it just sweeps everything along with it. And it doesn't care, you know. You might think, well, I don't want to go with the flood water, but if you're in the flood plain, it's going to sweep you. It's going to sweep you along, whether you want it to or not. So it's best to get out of the flood plain, okay? Flood plain of this extreme turmoil and fervor in the world that is coming. So, these videos keep on advancing this narrative, advancing this possibility. I'm not aware of any such presence in the world. I am not aware of that. That has this 100% inconsequential presence, just radiates that, not aware. But it's certainly possible that this could happen, because it's happened before. It's happened before. And many people went to saw those situations and profited from them immensely, and became disengaged from belief that there's something consequential in existence. And the fact is that never before in history has it been so important to have that type of help than right now. I'm on a diet. Lost 9 pounds in 11 days. Mostly juice, acai juice, and coconut juice, and carrot juice, and soup, things like that. Feeling fine. So my intention has always been to locate, to come across such a 100% reassurer, and to further that objective, and to be part of that objective here in the world, because that is truly the practical step in this world. We can talk about theoretically choose a new idea. Of course, that is the ultimate answer. But pragmatically, practically, you see, there is this turmoil coming in the world. And you have to be wise about that situation and find a way to be insulated from it. Because practically speaking, very few are at the point of choosing a new idea. It still, you know, seems to be some sticking points to that. And yet here comes the deluge, you know, the flood of turmoil. And we need to get out of that floodplain. Otherwise, we'll be swept away by it. And we'll reinvest and re-engage with belief, both with this belief system of existence. We'll re-engage with it in some way. And that, you know, gets swept away. It's horrible. So my focus in my life has always been this focus that, yes, there's going to be some help during these times. Hasn't come yet. And it's getting quite late, that is true. I do expect at some point there will be some sort of big boost, which means this simple reassurance. These type of reassurers, these ambassadors of reality, they don't have to say anything, really. They don't have to say anything because that's not where it's at. They're radiating reassurance to us that this is all inconsequential. This beyond words. It's beyond words because anybody can say it. Talk is cheap. But these ambassadors of reality, they radiate assurance, reassurance to us simply in their attitude. There's something there, you know, it's 100%. They're not concerned. They're absolutely not concerned about anything that takes place here. And that is a profound insulation from all this fervor. And we deserve this. You must have this attitude. We deserve it. We are absolutely deserving of this because we are one with reality. We are one with these ambassadors. They're no greater than we are. Their identity is no greater than ours. Everyone shares one identity of perfection in reality and total inclusion in reality. Total inclusion. Unconditional inclusion with no chance of ever being excluded. None. Zero. We all share the exact same inclusion. Okay. So these ambassadors of reality are just reminding us and reassuring us of this fact. And so all this existence, what does that have to do with our perfect inclusion in reality? We already perfectly have perfect inclusion. Full rights, full membership. Everyone does. Okay. They reassure us of that, and it's an attitude, it's a knowing. And words are always subject to interpretation, but there's a knowing beyond any words that is simply radiated out. Just can feel it to in all directions, 100%. You know, not just to one person or another, but just it's just there. It's like there's like a shade of a big tree, a banyan tree. Anyone can sit under the shade. You know, everyone's welcome to sit under that shade. Insulates you from the burning rays of the sun. So that situation is something I've always aimed for because I realized it's super helpful. Super helpful. And it hasn't happened yet, but it could. It certainly could. Whether it does or not, I don't know at this point. But I've certainly prepared in that direction. And understand that this type of reassurance, it doesn't require words, really. It does not require words. And going to such a place, if someone was here, reassure ambassador reality, you just sit quietly and just kind of tune into that reassurance beyond words. There's a tuning into that reassurance. And that takes an enormous burden off of us. It's incredibly helpful that we don't get caught up in the fervor of the times. And like I said, the fervor of the times that is coming is probably will be unprecedented. Not probably, it will be unprecedented. Exponentially greater than the fervor of previous times. Because it will be on so many different levels. And to not get caught up in that, you know, really requires either to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator, which would then bring you the experience of unconditional love, or to be insulated from this fervor by the presence of ambassador of reality who has 100% certainty that it's entirely inconsequential. And therefore, you don't have to get caught up in it. Those are the options. And we have to do the best that we can under the circumstances to not get caught up in all of this at all. But again, it is going to be so the flood, it will be so severe, the flood of turmoil so severe, and seeming consequentiality, the belief that it's consequential, will become so severe that there really has to be mitigating steps taken. Practical, pragmatic mitigating steps to insulate from that. There really has to be. We cannot just do business as usual, you know, because the situation will really be so, the flood will be so high, you know. We think we're out of the floodplain. Everybody thinks, oh, we're not in a floodplain, but, you know, this is different circumstances right now. Everybody's in the floodplain. Everyone's in the floodplain. Just like in California, they say every, you know, several hundred years, 500 years or whatever, there's a massive flood in the Central Valley, and we just haven't had one for a while. But historically, you know, the whole state of California, the Central Valley, the Bay Area, everything floods. There's some gigantic flood. And, you know, everybody's living in these areas think that they're not in a floodplain. You know, they didn't know that they're in a floodplain, but the fact is they're in a floodplain for the, you know, the 500-year flood. And so we in this world, we think, oh, we're not in a floodplain, but we are. We're in the floodplain of the once every, what, 26,000 years or something. Extreme change, turmoil, supposed consequentiality of existence. The pot gets stirred, and we're all in this floodplain. So pragmatically, practically, we need to be insulated from this floodplain. Okay? And that is a goal. That is a goal. Whether this goal is reached or not, time will tell. But I still hold this as a goal, that there can be some situation which is very serene, nothing happening, very calm, where there's silent sitting and reassurance. This can be shared via taping with the world. 1 second, right here. Be right back. And hopefully you don't get interruptions like that and in such a situation where everybody understands the purpose of the situation and that it's quiet sitting, you know, and everyone keeps it calm, peaceful, and everyone understands the purpose of the situation is to feel this assurance that there's no consequence to anything that happens in existence to our identity, to our home, to our experiencing, to anything that we really want. No consequentiality at all. So we're at now, we're at the 13th of October. So times are reaching the, you know, the situation is reaching the tipping point. Tipping point should be in November. Maybe the greatest tipping point will probably be in late December, towards the beginning of 2013. That will probably be, you know, the ultimate tipping point. But we can feel, you know, the things are starting to tip. You know, we can really feel in November, we'll really feel that it's starting to tip, and that itself will feel be very consequential. So the feeling of supposed consequentiality, the flood will start in November, really. Right now, we're holding our breaths, you know, whereas in November, it's going to the tipping, it will begin, and then probably towards 2013, we'll really feel, uh-oh, you know, the flood, here comes the flood, here comes the avalanche. So by that time, I certainly want to establish, something needs to be established, some momentum has to be established. I say October is very important to establish momentum. I'm certainly working on it. And you know, who knows how anything will go. There's a little squirrel tiptoeing across the walkway. Who knows how it will go? I don't know. I don't want to even try and speculate, but there's some indication that perhaps there's some possibility. Meanwhile, we have to do the very best possible at this time. Whatever situation we're in, we should really get ourselves in good enough shape. The squirrel is burying a walnut or something. Okay. Get ourselves in good enough shape that we feel like we can move our bodies, have some nerves about us, have some calm. Like I said, I'm dropping weight, I'm detoxing, I'm trying to give the whole system a rest, so that the at least the health is you know so-so, at least able to function in to some degree. Just try to make that your aim. Like, you know, let's say 3 more weeks, try to do something that optimizes how you feel, and that you feel like you're able to make a push. One more push. Okay, one more push. Because you may have to make one more push. So if you're feeling like, you know, you're out of gas and everything, just say, you know what? I'm gonna do one more, just one more push here. One more big push in my life. I'm not finished yet. Or if you're young, you know, you think, well, you got one more push, you got for sure. But try to optimize that. Try to optimize it and say, you know what, this is going to be a significant push, significant, very significant. Get yourself ready for that. Whatever you need to do, if it's to get rid of the clutter of your life, you know, if everything's just cluttered, everything's messy, if it's all dirty or something, just make an effort to free yourself up from too much stuff, too much clutter, stuff holding you down, something that's oppressive, stuff you've been procrastinating on. Get it done now. Get in, do some stretching, do a little exercising, maybe do some diet, give your body a rest, your digestive system, everything. Let it don't work it so hard. Don't keep stuffing yourself at this time. Whatever it is, just sort of suddenly get that resolve. You'll know what it is. When you get the resolve, you just decide, you know what? Until the election comes, I'm going to go for it. I'm just going to go for it 100% and see what happens then at that time. But don't leave this time on the table as far as your own life goes. Because again, there's nothing consequential that can ever happen in existence to your reality. However, if you get swept up in the belief that it is consequential, you won't know that. So it will seem consequential to you, and you'll be terrified, and you'll go on feeling very, very unstable and terrified. And certainly you don't want that. It'll prolong your misery, and you don't want that. It's not consequential to reality or to what you are, but it is. As long as you're believing it's consequential, you will suffer from that belief very badly. So it's super important to put yourself in a position at this time so your attention is somehow, you're able to gather your attention together. It's not all scattered. It's not all scattered. That you manage to get your focus, you know, into where you want it to be, and you're able to gather your attention, okay? Your attention is not being pulled by, oh, I'm feeling terrible. I weigh too much. I'm tired all the time. My attention's fragmented. I have to do so many things. My life is all cluttered up. I got too much stuff. I don't know what to do with this or that. And all this stuff can really make it too difficult on you. So at least resolve to do what you know you have to do to get your attention, gather your attention. Gather your attention. And for many, this has been a long process. I know for me, it has a long, long process of gradually gathering my attention and putting it where it needs to be, which is very important. Right now, it's on these videos, and hopefully the situation can become even more helpful. The best is yet to come. By gathering your attention, gather your attention. You'll notice your attention is fragmented here, fragmented there. All this stuff pulling at you. Try and disengage from that tar baby that's sticking to you. if you really realize that it's a crisis, you will be able to do things you couldn't do before. I may even jump on a bicycle today, which I haven't been on in, I can't even remember how long it's been, and actually try to get some cardio in, a little bit of cardio. I haven't had any cardio for a long, long time, so it's very, very weak there. I may do that, some stretching, you know, just try to get a feeling like, you know, tip-top shape, tip-top attention, ship's ready to sail kind of feeling. Why not? You know, what do we have to lose? Right? Hedge your bets that way. Don't go into November all out of sorts. That's not the right way to do it. Because the situation in the last 2 months of this year, going into 2013, will be one of trying to fragment your attention. And if it's already fragmented, you know, how are you going to resist that? The benefit of an ambassador of reality who's radiating 100% assurance is that their attention is not fragmented. And so you're able to put your attention on that very strongly and then not get fragmented. See, you're able to gather your attention and keep it very much gathered on truth, instead of being all fragmented into this belief system of existence, this mad, crazy dance of Maya, of duality, of belief that is constantly whirling around and trying to generate some threat to reality, which is what it's trying to do. It doesn't say that, but I'm saying that because I know that's a fact. That is what it's trying to do, which is futile, inconsequential. Reality cannot be threatened. What is real can never be threatened. So it's totally inconsequential. And it's trying to, by threatening reality, force the Prime Creator to change reality and make Spirit Prime Creator. That reality can't be threatened. Prime Creator cannot change reality. So none of that will ever happen. So existence will never give us what we believe we really want. It can never give us anything we really want at all. Because it won't. It doesn't give us reality, and reality is what we really want. See, it only gives us a false hope, a false promise, a waiting. That's not what we really want. So there's nothing in existence that can give us what we really want, and it's totally inconsequential to what we are, what our home is, what our experiencing is, what reality is. Totally inconsequential. To be reminded of this fact is the true teaching. It is the true teaching. We've gotten off on side trips of thinking, you know, there's some other stuff we need to know or to learn or something. Not true. It is simply to be reminded of this fact. To be reminded of facts is the spiritual path. To be reminded of what is true is the spiritual path. There is no other spiritual path. How could there be? We simply need to be reminded of what is always true. Because it's true right now, it always will be true. It cannot be altered or changed. And to be reminded of that is the path of salvation. To be reminded of what is always true. And can never be threatened, can never be changed. Because that is reality, that we are one, we have perfect inclusion in that. And that is the truth. To be reminded of that, of this perfect inclusion, perfect non-threat, perfect inclusion, be reminded of this, that is the path, that is the spiritual path. And we can be reminded of it in different levels, conceptually, clarifying it, etc. But there's more profound levels than that. There's the actual presence of one that is 100% aware of this, and you know, that's a, you know, super profound level. And then there's actually the level of choosing a new idea, where you experience unconditional love from within seamlessly in every moment. That is then the ultimate reminder, the ultimate reminder. So we have maybe three different reminders. We have the conceptual, we have the ambassadors of reality radiating the reassurance to us, and then we have the actual choosing of a new idea and experiencing unconditional love all the time, which is what the ambassadors of reality are experiencing, unconditional love continuously without a break. That's so that is the ultimate here. So we have those three basic steps to take. Right now, this is the first one, is gathering your attention, clarifying, conceptually clarifying, understanding that there are three steps, understanding, you know, how you can increase your assurance even beyond anything conceptually, that it can be in the presence of a ambassador of reality who has 100% certainty, and then ultimately that can lead to choosing a new idea. Meditation, contemplation, clarification can also lead to choosing a new idea. That is also possible, which is the third step, the ultimate step here, where we no longer even experience the play of the world is like a shadow play, and it doesn't affect how we feel at all, because we're experiencing unconditional love. So at that point, we would be ambassadors of reality, radiating 100% assurance. So what we're trying to do here is to get the first step strong enough that it can lead into the second step, which is the opportunity to simply sit with an ambassador of reality. That opportunity, if it ever comes, hopefully it will come, that would be what's called a second step. Enough conceptual clarity enables one to then take the second step and benefit from it and be able to put it in the right context and say, okay, this is the second step where I'm getting that 100%, that reassurance, experiencing that 100% certainty. And then that will lead to the third step, which is my choosing to the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which will then lead to me experiencing unconditional love seamlessly. So if we have that clarification, we'll be able to take that second step. Be able to take it. So I'm trying to get myself into that position so I can take that second step. And then by taking that second step, helping others, you know, reassuring others, like, hey, you can take it too. You know, if you have enough conceptual clarity, you can also take that second step. If somebody, you know, needs to say, yeah, I can take that and do it. And then that needs to be, you know, an outreach needs to take place, an awareness needs to take place that this is available, a second step is available. And that, you see, if you have the conceptual clarity, then you can put it in the context, you can understand what's going on, and then you can benefit from it. Whereas if you don't have it, you will think like the ambassador of reality is here to be some kind of activist and deal with all the consequences that are taking place and try to generate good consequences here in the dream or something, which is not their purpose at all. So, you know, you will be at odds with the situation. It won't work out. It won't work out. You'll feel frustrated and disappointed and confused and bitter and angry and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So putting it in the right context is super important. These videos here are really an outreach to help you put it in the right context. That's what they're doing. If you can at least get a sense of it and you're okay with it, then you say, hey, you know what? I probably could benefit from a second step at some point. Probably could benefit from it. I won't be like, come in with like an agenda of saying, okay, I need to convince this ambassador of reality to follow me into battle. Because I have a battle on my hands and I have to defeat the bad guys, or I have to make the good guys win, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I have to try and convince this ambassador that their purpose in this world here is to follow me into battle and help me win this battle. If you can see through that and say, ah, no, that's not it, then you're at peace with the situation. You can flow with the situation. You can benefit from the situation. There's not a conflict there. You know, you're not at odds with the situation. You're not at odds with it. If you're not at odds with the situation, you just really settle into it. So these videos definitely have been aiming towards that second step without getting fixated on the second step at all. I mean, we have to do the work. The work has to get done. We can't be just constantly hoping and thinking about the future. We have to deal with right now and conceptually clarifying it, putting the right context in the place, But certainly, a second step would be beneficial to the world, very beneficial, especially during these times that are coming up. But as at this moment, I have no information whatsoever about it. But you know, it's possible. It's really possible. I'm not giving up on it. Sometimes, you know, things happen at the right time for some reason. Perhaps waiting for the context to be matured, you know, to have a mature contextual understanding and clarification of the situation, so it not at odds with it. Not at odds with it, you know, kind of a very smooth fit rather than being all at odds with it. That's a hopeful interpretation of the situation. But gosh, we certainly don't want to go forward in this world without significant help, really. Because, you know, we may think that we have it figured out, but the people around us certainly don't. And they're going to be screaming at us, you know, what are you doing? You know, look what's happening. You gotta get with it. You know, the pressure will be intense. It's like you live on a lake and you think, you know, your water is real pure where you are and you think everything's fine. But somebody on the other side of the lake is dumping pollution in the lake. Just terrible. And you think, well, you know, that's over there. I'm over here. But the pollution mixes with the water, and one day you look at your where you are, and all the water is all polluted and stinking where you are, and you say, how did that happen? It's like the collective consciousness of the planet. Everyone affects everyone else. The conscious at the level of consciousness. So all this fervor and stuff will seep into us, you know, unless we're really insulated from it. It's just like houses. They have, you know, very sophisticated insulation now. The double layered windows, you know, all the caulking, all the insulation, sometimes external coatings of like sheetrock, different types of sheetrock, and just many layers to insulate the house so the cold doesn't get in. If you don't have all that insulation, it's all drafty and stuff. The cold from outside gets into the house, gets in there. So we can be insulated from the world to some degree, and we need to have a very strong insulation at coming up from the world so the agitation does not get into us and start driving us to you know, action, you know, battling consequences. Maybe that squirrel there was carrying the nut and was, you know, digging and burying the nut there somewhere to insulate the nut, you know, insulate the nut for the food to keep it keep it as a food source. Maybe that said something, that it, to insulate ourselves from the agitation so that we don't get swept up in the belief system, in belief in consequentiality, belief in process, belief process can give us something we really want. We don't get swept up in that. Instead, we stay focused. Our attention is gathered and focused on choosing a new idea, because that's ultimately what we have to do. Ultimately, we have to do that. We have to go beyond belief. How do you do that? Choose a different causal agent, because belief is being caused by an idea, by the idea of wanting to be prime creator. Spirit is causing, giving rise to belief. And so to go beyond belief, we have to choose a different causal agent, which is the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That gives rise to unconditional love. This overlay that we would call unconditional love, it overlays all belief equally. We have to do that. So our focus and attention needs to be at that goal, on that goal. But the problem is the world, the way what's going to happen, the world, it's going to be super difficult to keep yourself focused on that goal if we're not insulated. Very difficult. Prohibitively difficult. We'll go forward from this day, from the 13th of October 2012, gathering our attention, putting ourselves in tip-top condition with a gathered intention, with the intent of continuing to clarify context conceptually and expecting at some point to be able to take the second step, which is being insulated from the situation by having our attention be, you know, gathered even more intensely by reassurance that all of this is entirely inconsequential to reality and to what we are effortlessly and eternally included in, perfectly included in, which is reality. We will continue to move this forward, continue to get the conceptual clarity here. I will continue to give what I can to get you, you know, up to speed. You don't need much. It's just like if you're out of shape, you just need to stretch a bit to move around, to maybe lose some weight, to get active a little bit, just so you feel, yeah, I can move again. It's like that. Just taking the rust off is super helpful. Don't have to, you know, be a world beater at this point. You just have to get feel a sense of, I'm okay with the fact that all this is totally inconsequential. Totally inconsequential. And there's nothing I have to do for that to be a fact. It's already a fact. It's not up to us to establish that as a fact at all. All we need to do is accept that it is a fact, not establish it. So it is helpful, super helpful to work at conceptual clarity, super helpful. But again, it is a precursor to step number two. Step number two is then a precursor to step number three. And so let us go in that direction, continue to gather your attention together, okay? Very great, go for it, that's it.